Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of The Last Viking by Griff Hosker, narrated by Marston York. Prologue. I am Erik, and I am the last Viking who still lives to the south of the land of ice and fire. I am old now, and weary beyond words. When the monotone arrow slammed into my knee, it left me with a wound I carry yet, and I cannot shake either the pain or the lack of movement. I carry other wounds, but they do not keep me awake at night as I moan in my sleep. I know that I make such noises for my wife, laughing deer mentions them when we rise. It is lucky that for the last few years we have lived in peace. Since we defeated Eagle Claws and the men he led to try to take my magical weapons, the clan of the bear had prospered and grown. Although my friend Brave Eagle had not returned since our victory, some of his tribe, the tribe we had briefly joined, journeyed over the Ridge of Blue to our home, Eagle Shadow on the Shenandoah. When I found the grassy knoll, I had chosen it because it allowed us to grow and gave us safety from predators. Now, our long house and storerooms almost filled it. We had grown so much that soon we would need to build a second longhouse. We would have to take more of the trees and cultivate more of the land by the ditch to provide food. We had added a ditch across a loop in the river to make a barrier against our enemies. It was a dry ditch, but we had not broken through to the river. However, with the river, we had surrounded our home. When I had slept in the dream world after the stone club had cracked my skull, the Volva, Gitta, came to me in spirit form. She told me I was no longer needed as a warrior, and I gave away my sword and my hand axe. I hoped that the spirit who had guided me since our time on Bear Island was right, but I also knew that the three sisters spun their webs to entrap men. I was still vigilant. I made sure that one of the men from the clan walked around our land each day looking for signs of enemies. We had chosen our eyrie well and surveyed the valley below us. We knew the trails that enemies might use and the signs that they might leave. We were a small clan, and that helped us to identify each other by the marks we left on the ground. Chapter 1. The time after the battle was a good one. Laughing Deer and I spent more time together. Gita was right, and I did not need to be a warrior. I was still the best of sailors, and I took the snekker out to fish whenever I could. I took with me those who were unfamiliar with the snekker, and I taught them what I knew. Golden Bear and Brave Cub were the best sailors. The other snekker, Doe, was theirs, and they fished too. When I was not fishing, I spent time with Laughing Deer. We were the elders of the clan, and others took on the tasks that Laughing Deer had once called her own. When we sat on the two stumps at the top of the steep slope that led to the river, we could look west and see the virgin forest. We enjoyed each other's company. Of course, being Laughing Deer, she could not help but comment if a task was not performed properly. The two of us often acted as the carers of the young. When babies were no longer suckled, their mothers could take on more tasks, and the two of us often sat playing with a clutch of toddlers. I would pull faces and make funny noises while Laughing Deer would tell them tales. She was the heart of the clan. The women would come to her to ask for advice and to help make decisions. I was unnecessary. We were not at war and we had no land to explore, and so I was able to be the old man who watched the world slip by and his clan grow. Those were the best of times. They were the happiest time of our lives, for we had peace and we had comfort. My son, Brave Cub, and his wife, Redbreast, had just been delivered of a son who they named Otter's Teeth when the three sisters spun. Laughing Deer became ill. Her sickness came just the day after my grandson was born. She was still laughing at his name because when he had suckled, he had nipped his mother. When she suddenly gripped her middle and yelped in pain herself. Laughing Deer was the healer in the family, and until she was stricken, she was never sick. No matter what we did, we could not ease her pain. She joked that she had cooked some bad fish. We knew it was not bad fish, for we all ate from the same pot and no one else was ill. Had she been a warrior, I would have said that there was some piece of metal within her body, for she held her right side as though it was a wound. It took a day for her to die, and I never moved from her side the whole time. I held her hand while my family did all that they could for her. We used poultices, salves, and medicines, all of which had cured before, but none of them worked. She gripped my hand tightly and our eyes locked. There were unspoken words between us as I held the hand of Laughing Deer. I was not a healer, and others toiled to make her well. Little White Dove came into her own, for she was a tower of strength. Even so, the pain became increasingly worse and forced involuntary tears from Laughing Deer's eyes. I think she knew she was dying, for there was one moment of clarity when the paroxysm of pain eased and she could talk. She whispered in my ear, "Do not mourn my death, Erik the Navigator, for my life since you took me from the Penobscot has been a blessing. I never thought that you would outlive me, but I am glad that you do, for you are the heart of this clan. When I am gone, we will cure this ill. When I am gone, I shall return as Gita does and bring you comfort. When you are in the steam hut and smoke the pipe filled with the dream leaf, close your eyes and I shall be there. We have brought up the children well, and Little White Dove shall now be the matriarch. Kiss me, husband, while the pain abates." I kissed her, and she smiled. I began to hope that the ailment, whatever it was, had gone. Indeed, when Little White Dove came in and saw her mother with a smile on her face, she thought the worst had passed. We were both wrong, for within the time it takes to hoist the sail on a snecker, it came back worse, and the next hours saw her scream and arch her back. When she went still, it was sad, but a relieved sadness, for she would no longer be in pain. I held her body to mine until Moose Blood and Brave Cub peeled me away. "Our mother would not want this, father. We have to bury her. The clan needs to say words, and then we can begin to mourn." Moose Blood, now a man grown and the next leader of the clan, was right. I obeyed him. The women of the clan laid Laughing Deer out in her best clothes, the ones she saved for special occasions like the winter solstice. My sons dug her grave and we chose a spot where the evening sun would shine as it set in the west. It was close to the place where we had sat and enjoyed some peace. Now she would enjoy eternal peace. We had ever journeyed west and it seemed right to do so. Wrapped in a deerskin, for she was Laughing Deer, we put her in the ground, and then each of us piled soil upon it. My sons and the other men of the clan had brought flat stones from the river, and we placed those on top before the last earth was placed there. As we stood around, the family held hands to make a circle, and they all looked to me to speak. The words almost choked as they rose in my throat, but I knew that I had a duty to speak, and I did so. They were the hardest words I ever spoke. "Laughing Deer, you always said that I saved you from the Penobscot, but in truth you saved me. I think that without you, I would have died on Bear Island. My bones would lie there still, unmourned and without a marker. You gave me a family and a clan. You made sure that the blood of a Norseman would still flow through the bodies of those we brought into this world. You were my rock and my friend. I do not know how I will get through each day without you by my side. I will have to force myself to open my eyes each morning and take from the dreams that I know will be of you." I dropped to my knees and prostrated myself on the earth,
tears came flooding from my eyes. Mooseblood and Brave Cub lifted me to my feet. Little White Dove wiped the tears from my face, saying,
"This is not how our mother would want you to be, Father. Her spirit will live in this place. I know that. Her spirit will be in Otter's teeth. The Allfather has brought one life into this world and taken another from it. You have a clan and a family who will need to be as a mother and a father. This is meant to be. This is weird."
She was right, but that did not take away the pain that I felt inside me. My children were right, and life went on. We were a small clan, but we had young mouths to feed. When I had first come to the land on the Patawamka, there had just been 6 of us in the clan. Now, there were more than 20 of us. Mooseblood had 3 children, and Little White Dove and Fierce Water had 2 each. The 3 firstborn from Eagle's Shadow, 2 boys and a girl, had all seen more than 6 summers. They now worked with their mothers. They tended the crops and helped to pick the nuts and berries that the clan relied on. Soon, the 2 eldest boys would learn to hunt, and my grandson, Waterbird, would be introduced to the Snekke. It is strange, but only those of my blood were truly happy sailing the Snekke. Fierce Water had taken to sailing quite well, but he was never as comfortable as Mooseblood, Brave Cub, and Golden Bear. I wondered if any of Little White Dove's children would be sailors. The 2 Snekke were now old. Gita did not have many voyages left in her. That spring, when we took the 2 Snekke from their winter homes and examined them, I saw what my sons did not. Gita was no longer sound. I saw that the timbers, despite the frequent painting of pine tar, were rotting. I let them put dough in the river and fill her hull with ballast. When they returned to carry Gita down the slope, I shook my head. "Gita is no longer whole. She will go on the water no more." Golden Bear asked,
"What do we do with her? Break her up for spares?"
Golden Bear was eminently practical. I shook my head. "No, my son, she deserves a better end." I stood. "When I die, then you will bury me in the Snekke. I am the last Viking, and it is fitting that I should have a Viking funeral." Long Nose was close by.
"A Viking funeral?"
I nodded. "When a chief dies, he is placed in a Snekke with his weapons around him. The sail is hoisted and the Snekke is set on fire. It is the way I wish to be buried." Mooseblood exchanged a look with Brave Cub. "Father, our mother would like you to look forward to life." I smiled. "And I do. I do not intend to die any time soon." My hand went to the hammer of Thor around my neck. "But the sisters spin, and a man must plan. This makes me happy. I know that I shall have the funeral I want, no matter how far in the future that is. Place her back in the winter store, for we must plan and build a new one. The clan is growing, and we need 2 Snekke." They looked relieved and knew what I meant. When we had lived along the Patawamka, we had devised a way to fish using a net hung between 2 Snekke. It was a quick way to harvest the river. When the Shenandoah was full, we used the same method. You could not do it with birch bark boats, for they could easily capsize. My sons had helped me to build dough, but the others had not. I gathered them around me to explain how it would be done. There would be 10 of us, and in theory, it should have been easier. "The first thing we need is wood. This is good, as we need to clear more land for crops. We need 1 tree that will have a natural curve. That will be the keel. It will be that tree that determines the length of the Snekke. Then we need straight trees that we will hew and split. We will need to season them. We need a good, strong sapling for the mast. When that is done, we will need tree nails. We have some, but not enough. When we have found the trees, then I will go with 4 of you, and we will visit the Cave of the Bear to fetch iron. While we do that, Brave Cub will show you all how to make pine tar.
That is no bad thing, for we can use the pine tar for other things too.
Moose blood beamed. This is better, father.
I frowned. Better?
For the first time since mother was taken from us, you seem positive and happy. This is what she would wish.
I nodded and smiled. What I had not said was that this snecker would be named Laughing Deer. Nor did I tell them that inside my heart still ached for my wife. At night my bed was lonely, and I often found myself reaching out to put my arm around her. But she was not there. We had flint axes as well as some hatchets and hand axes made from iron. We would be able to work the wood better this time. We set off to examine the stand of trees that we would hew. I had decided to clear the land on the eastern side of the ditch. We could cultivate that land, but more importantly, it would give us a clear line of sight and prevent enemies from sneaking up to our ditch. In the years since the war, we had lived in peace, but I knew that one day an enemy would come and we had to be prepared. The straight ones were easy to find, but the curved one hid from us. Trees are living things, and I did not mind that the tree was elusive. Golden Bear and Moose Blood came with me to head deeper into the forest while the others cut down the 8 trees we had selected. The new men in the clan had yet to learn that making pine tar was far harder than hewing trees. That task would come next. When we found the wood for the keel, it was a hawk that showed us the way. It flew into the sky when we neared the branch he was using to look for prey. It drew my eye up and I saw the tree. When it had been young, something had leaned against it so that it grew not straight up, but was bent like a bow. Had the curve been too extreme, it would have been of no use, but whatever had bent it had not done so for long. It was perfect. Go and fetch axes. I will wait here. In truth, the walk had made my knee ache. I would need the steam hut and the dream leaves to enable me to sleep. I sat on a large stone that lay close to the bottom of the tree. I wondered if it had been the stone that had made the tree bend. I put my hand on the tree. We are going to cut you, my friend, but we will not take you all. We will leave your stump. Perhaps you will begin to grow again. The part we take will live and fly across the water. I do not take your life. I just change it. To give the tree a chance to regrow, I had my sons cut it at my chest height. It would never be as magnificent again, but it would live. And as I had discovered after Laughing Deer had died, you looked for reasons to live. When the tree crashed to the ground, it cut a swathe through lesser trees and there was more light. It gave me hope that the tree might regrow. The damaged trees could be harvested for kindling. We trimmed the smaller branches and left them in a pile. My grandchildren would be sent to fetch in the wood, which would not be wasted. It would be firewood for the winter. It took all our efforts to drag it back to Eagle Shadow. The other timbers were there already. That first day of work took it out of me, and I went into the steam hut and lit my pipe. We had 2 kinds of leaves that we smoked. One I called the dream leaf, and she had a strong smell. I used it judiciously and mainly when the pain was too severe. The smoking of the dream leaf normally coincided with a visitation by the spirits. I was alone, and that day Laughing Deer and Geeta both came to me. Perhaps it was exhaustion, or maybe the spirit of the tree had spoken to them, but they came. They said not a word, but both smiled at me. Their mere presence was enough, and I was comforted with the thought that Laughing Deer and Geeta were together. It came to me as they smiled that I never saw Snorri with Geeta. I hoped he was in Valhalla. I was content, and that night's sleep was one of the best I had enjoyed since my wife was taken from me. While Golden Bear took the grandchildren to fetch the kindling, the rest of us spent the morning stripping the bark from the trees.
The better pieces would be used to mend or make boats, while the rest was collected to be dried as kindling. I marked the trees with a piece of charcoal, and the others cut them all into the same lengths. Nothing would be wasted. We left them beneath Geta's old sail to season, and then returned to the stumps of the 8 trees. While the keel was a birch tree, the others were mainly pine, and the roots could be burned to make pine tar. Moose Blood and I showed them how to make the oven. That took all day. We had made pine pots while Laughing Deer was alive, and we would use them to collect the pine tar. I set them to dig out the roots. That was back-breaking work, and made the hewing of the trees seem like an easy task. When we headed back to the longhouse, I said, "Tomorrow I will take Golden Bear, Black Feather, Long Nose, and Bjor Tooth. We will take tools to dig the iron. Moose Blood, I'll leave you in charge of the village." Brave Cub said, "Why do you have to go? We know where the cave is. And you know how to break down the iron, but we need all the clan to know these things. When I am gone, then you will have to pass these skills on. While I can still move, let me be of some use to the clan, eh? Besides, I am still the chief, and I decide these things." Once more, my sons exchanged looks, and I wondered how long it would be before they challenged me. We took not only tools and food, but also weapons. We were moving far from the safety of the river. Thus far, we had not encountered others close to our home, but since the attack by Eagle Claws, we were no longer hidden. One day someone would come, and they might be belligerent. I took nothing for granted. I let the others bear most of the task of carrying. I had my bow and my sayaks, along with my ale skin and a satchel with food. It had been many years earlier when I had found the cave in the place we called the Iron Hills. This would only be my third visit. Black Feather and Long Nose would have to be shown the way. This time, I used my sayaks to mark the trees where we turned with a rune. To any who did not know, the mark would have no significance, but my clan would know, and long after I was gone, they would find their way to the Bear Cave on the Blue Ridge. I knew that the journey up to the cave would be easier than the one coming down. My bad knee hated coming down. I did not show my pain to the others, but bore it stoically. I was actually enjoying the peace of the forest. My son was a good tracker and knew that we were the only men to walk along this trail. We saw signs of other creatures, especially white-tailed deer, but ours were the only signs of humans. It was as if I had my own kingdom. I thought back to Orkneyar. That had seemed relatively empty, but within an hour of leaving our home, we would have found other homes. Even in the land of ice and fire, we all lived on top of one another. Here, there was room to move and to breathe. I knew that others had lived in the valley, but from the signs that I had found, that had been many generations ago. Perhaps when my clan was no more, the animals would reclaim their valley. I consoled myself with the thought that at least my spirit would still be here. The last time I had visited the cave, all that remained of the bear were a few gnawed bones. When we reached it, I saw that the bones were gone and the stink of death had departed. I would not violate the cave by camping inside. Instead, we would use the campfire we had used on our first visit. It had led Eagle Claws to us, and that was a sobering thought. It was too late to begin work when we arrived, and so we set up a pot and lit a fire. We had brought enough food to make a hunter's stew, and while I tended to the fire, the other four foraged for food. The cave was a peaceful place, but also a sad one. The bear had been entombed in the cave and died a long and lingering death. I said a prayer to the bear's spirit as the flames licked the kindling. No creature deserved to die alone. The warmth of the fire was comforting. After we had eaten and we lay in our sleeping blankets, we spoke. It was just Golden Bear and me at first, but the others joined in. "When this iron is no more, father, what then?"
There will be other places where we can find it. I'm not skilled enough to know where, and it may well be that we rely on the three sisters to lead us there, but I am confident that there will be other places where it is found. I smiled. And you and my other sons know how to recognize it.
Soon, I waved a hand at the other three, all of you will have that skill. I hope that you pass this knowledge on to your children too, for that is how the clan will survive.
Longnose said,
It is a good land, Shaman of the Bear, but we are still few in number.
I nodded at Bjortooth. Willowleaf and her family found us. There will be others. The world can be a cruel place, Longnose. There are many men like Eagle Claws, and not enough like Brave Eagle.
Blackfeather had recently married Willowleaf, and he smiled.
My wife says that had you not found her, then the four of them might have died. You gave them the chance of life.
And I was happy to do so. I was saved on more than one occasion by another. The Allfather is always there for those in need.
What of those who are not as lucky as we?
I looked at Bjortooth. The three sisters can be willful, Bjortooth, and the Allfather sometimes loses the battle of wits with the Norns.
I had forgotten what hard, back-breaking work was involved in gathering the ore. We had brought large stone clubs to break down the rocks, but it was the collecting of the rocks that made us have to work together and sweat and curse. We worked together to find large pieces, which we would break up to make carrying them back easier. I had collected the smaller pieces on my first visit. I knew that the next time I came, if there was a next time, we would need more of us, and we would have to spend more time here. By the end of the day, we had enough to make the trenails and a few axes. We now had more men who could learn the skill of sheeping wood, and they would need tools. The hard day of work gave us all a healthy appetite. Bjortooth's skill with a bow meant we had a squirrel for our evening meal, and the exercise allowed me to sleep almost pain and dream-free. I woke more refreshed than I might have expected. I was now an old man. I was the first awake, and as I made water, I listened to the sounds of the forest. It was never totally silent. That morning, I thought I heard something different from what I expected. I could not make it out, but it jarred with me. Putting it to the back of my mind, I woke the others and ate the remains of the stew. We had come prepared, and I spread the weight of the ore between all the bags we had made. We tied the tools to the bags and carried our bows. It would be a much slower progress from the ridge and the iron hills than it was to get there. I led, for I had done this journey the most, and besides, I was the slowest. We had travelled a mile when I heard the mewling from ahead. The others heard it too. I raised my hand for silence whilst stringing my bow and taking an arrow from the bag on my waist. The noise was coming from our right. I slipped off my oar bag and the others emulated me. I waved them to my left and right. Whatever was making the noise had to be investigated. Leaving something unknown within walking distance of Eagle's shadow could be disastrous. It became clear that the mewling I had heard was not an animal, but a baby. As we drew closer to the sound, we also heard an animal. It was a dog, and it was growling. We cleared some trees and saw a woman in distress with a baby trying to feed at her breast. A rangy, mangy, and ill-fed dog stood growling protectively before them. Blackfeather raised his bow. Laying mine down, I said, Put your weapons down. The dog is protecting them. He does not deserve to die for doing his duty. Reaching into my satchel, I took out a handful of dried venison. I proffered my open palm, and the growling ceased, but the dog still viewed me with suspicion. There's a good boy. We mean you no harm. I know not why, but I spoke in Norse. Hunger overcame his suspicion, and he took the venison and swallowed it in one. The rest of you, stay back. I knelt next to the woman. She was alive, but only just. I did not recognize the clan markings nor the tribal artifacts, and I knew she was not Monoton, Penobscot, or Powhatan. Her eyes opened and words burst forth like a torrent. I understood not one of them. Does anyone recognize the words?
Just one or two, Shaman. I recognize the words baby and child. Her clothes do not look like any I have seen.
Beortooth was Powhatan, but had lived with the Monoton as a captive. They looked to me to be more like the dress of the Mohawks, but they lived so far to the north that I dismissed the idea immediately. The baby was still trying to get milk, but the woman's body was so emaciated as to suggest that the baby would go hungry. Having said that, it was not a newborn. I now recognize the ages of children. Approach, but do so slowly. I do not want the dog alarmed. The dog did appear to be calmer. Perhaps my gentleness had helped. I slipped my ale skin around and held the spout to her mouth. She drank some and tried to smile. She said something else. It had a more familiar sound to it, and I thought she was giving me thanks. Golden Bear had also given the dog some dried meat and was stroking the animal. Long Nose and Black Feather knelt next to the woman, and it was Long Nose who noticed the wound.
Shaman, she has been hurt.
He pointed to the tear in her side. The hide she wore had been cut, and I saw an angry wound. Long Nose leaned in and sniffed.
There is badness there, Shaman.
He shook his head. We will help you. I smiled as I said the words and I mimed helping her up. She shook her head and instead held the baby out to me. I took the swaddled bundle, but the effort must have been too much for the woman. Her back arched and she fell back. Long Nose knelt next to her and shook his head. She was dead. The dog went to the woman and began to howl. The baby began to cry, and I instinctively did what I would have done with my grandchildren. I made soothing noises, and holding the baby close to me, patted its back. You must bury her. She has chosen a quiet place to die. Fetch the bags and the tools. It will add time to our journey, but it cannot be helped. Left alone, I spoke to the dog, the baby, and the dead woman. The Allfather has sent you here to join my clan. I know not whence you have come, but now you are part of the clan of the bear. Once more I spoke in Norse, for I was speaking as much to the spirits as the three before me. Amazingly, the dog ceased howling, and the baby fell asleep. Perhaps the crying had wearied it. Golden Bear managed to get the dog away from the body, and the four of them dug a grave. They gently folded her arms, and then they covered her first with rocks and then with soil. We took nothing from her. She would journey to the next world with her bracelets, necklets, and hair fastenings in place. Whoever waited for her would recognize her. And now we journey home. Put your bags on your backs, and then you, Golden Bear, can hold the child while I don mine.
We can carry your share, Father.
I want no one wearied to the point that they fall. I have been chosen to be the one to carry the child, and I will do so. When my bag was on my back, I took the sleeping baby, and we headed back to the trail. I spoke to the dog. I used the Norse word for wolf.
Ulla, come.
The dog obeyed and trotted at my side. I'm not sure it was the words that made it obey. More likely it was protecting the child. We stopped frequently. The baby woke once and I gave it some ale from the ale skin. Had we had any milk, I would have given the baby some, but we had none and the baby clearly wanted liquid. It slept again. I knew that it would have soiled itself, but I did not want to unfasten the swaddling. We had enough women in the clan for that to be dealt with more effectively at Eagle's Shadow.
When we were close, I sent Bjortooth to run ahead and warn them of our approach. I was weary beyond words. My knee had complained for the last 5 miles, and I feared that it would not hold up on the climb up the path. The light that glowed from the open door made me smile. It was like a beacon guiding us home. As we entered the longhouse, Willowleaf, now the oldest woman in the clan, came to take the baby from me. Ulla was still at my side. While the women took the baby to the fire where they could tend to it, Mooseblood and the others helped to take the bag from my back. "Here is a tale, father." I nodded. "Aye, Mooseblood. Fetch the animal some water and food." My eldest son shook his head. "You look ready to fall, and yet all that you can think of is the needs of a mangy animal." "Ulla here protected the dying woman and the child. He deserves to be treated like a hero. He is now part of the clan." Willowleaf called over.
"And we have another girl in the clan. What did you name her, Shaman?"
"I did not."
Golden Bear said,
"She is strong, as was her mother and her dog. Let us call her Iron Will, for surely she has iron in her."
It seemed right to name her thus. Our late arrival and the need for food meant that we did not go to bed as early as we normally did. We had much to talk about. There was much speculation about the woman, the wound, and the baby. We had two nursing mothers, and between them they ensured that Iron Will had milk and was put to sleep with the other babies. We sat and spoke. I largely listened. I knew that the spirits would talk to me either when I slept or in the steam hut. The spirits talking was a good thing for the clan. "Did you notice that her moccasins were worn right through?" "Aye, Bjortooth. She had been walking for many days."
"The wound, too, was not a recent one. Where could she have come from?"
"I cannot see Brave Eagle or his clan letting her walk through their land in that condition."
Golden Bear suddenly banged the table.
"The West. It is the only thing that makes sense. She has come from the West, and that is why none of us recognized either her words or her clothes. We know the Monoton live to the north and the east, but we have never explored the river to the west."
Mooseblood smiled. "Perhaps, little brother, when we have made our new snecke, we should sail that way." Fierce Water shook his head.
"Better not to poke the bear, Mooseblood. Let us stay hidden here."
Little White Dove smiled. "We are the clan of the bear, Fierce Water. There may be others like Iron Will's mother. What do you say, father?"
"I say that all that I have heard is good, but Mooseblood is right. Until we have the new snecke, we can do nothing, and I had a mind to explore the land to the west of us before we made this discovery. Perhaps I have another voyage left in me, eh?"
Silence filled the longhouse.
"Surely you will stay here, father, and let me or one of the others take the snecke."
"Mooseblood, I am still Erik the Navigator. This task was clearly appointed for me. But you are right. We build the boat first." I stood. "And now I will go to bed." I had not smoked the dream leaf, nor had I used the steam hut, but that night I dreamed. I saw again the roaring waterfall that had haunted my dreams before I had even met Laughing Deer. I saw the woman who had died, and she was alive and laughing with other women of her tribe. They were washing clothes in the calmer waters below the waterfall. My dream grew dark, and I slept.
Chapter 2. Ulla kept as close to Iron Will as he could. Willowleaf decided that the dog was too smelly to be allowed inside, and she ejected the animal. Each morning, when the door to the longhouse was opened, Ulla would be waiting. He would not move until he had seen Iron Will,
and we began to bring out the babe so that the dog could see she was well. He began to follow me around and gradually transferred his affection to me. He was still attentive, especially when I and Will cried, but that was less frequent now that there were so many mothers around. Both the child and the dog began to put on weight and look healthier. To satisfy my daughter, Bjortooth and I bathed the dog. Ulla was not happy about the bath and growled his disapproval, but the dried venison trick worked and he eventually submitted. His aroma became less pungent. I began to organise the men and appointed them tasks in the making of the snekker. While we waited for the wood to season, I had them, under Moose Blood's supervision, split the logs into planks. It would help with the seasoning, and I knew that the new ones would make mistakes, so the task would not be completed as quickly had it been just me and my sons who were doing the work. Moose Blood had managed to make the pine tar, and it was now in sealed pots awaiting the hull to be completed. I set to making the trenails and tools. Golden Bear liked the work, as did Long Nose and Fierce Water. They became my assistants as we first broke up the ore and then melted it. We had the moulds already made, and over those first days melted and poured molten metal into them. I knew that what we produced would not be perfect. Only Golden Bear had any real skill in the process, but mistakes could be borne. The disasters with the axe heads became the trenails and arrowheads that we would use. The five of us had brought more ore back from the Iron Hills than I had anticipated. I did not see myself returning there any time soon. I made myself a hatchet to replace the axe I had given to my son. It was a test of my skill as a weaponsmith. I found I enjoyed making something that I could spend hours finishing. It turned out to be the best weapon I ever made. It was sharp and kept its edge well. Once the tools and nails were finished, we used river sand to take some of the roughness from them, and then began to sharpen them. It was time-consuming work. We also had animals to hunt and fish to catch. It made for full days and nights that saw us collapse into our beds. I did not dream again, or at least I did not remember the dreams I had. I decided that after 7 days of work, I would enter the dream world through the portal of the steam hut. The new arrivals and the hard work seemed to give me a new lease of life. I had not mentioned it to anyone, for now that Laughing Deer was gone, I had no one in which to confide, but I was looking forward to a journey to the west. I knew that the river flowed to the south and west. I would not leave the river, and if that took me more to the south than to the west, then so be it. I wondered how the woman had crossed the river. I knew that there were rapids and shallows, but I did not think that a woman with a baby and a wound would either risk or be able to cross. As I sharpened the curved axe that would be used to shape the streaks of the snekker, I found myself smiling. I had come a long way since I had left Orkneyar. When I thought of the voyage that I had made south from the land of ice and fire, I had not known if I would find land. How much easier would it be sailing along a river with the land close enough to touch? Golden Bear said,
"It is good to see you smile again, Father. When Mother died, I thought you had died too."
Part of me did die, but new life, my grandchildren and the foundling have shown me that there is still a purpose for me. I am the last Viking in this land, and the All-Father still sees a need for me. The day he tires of me, then he will let me join your mother and the rest of my clan. Golden Bear shook his head. He did not like what he saw as morbid thoughts. To me, they were not morbid. I knew that I was old, and Laughing Deer's death had shown me that death could come in many forms. The tools finished, and the wood still to be seasoned, left us enough time to go on a hunt across the river for white-tailed deer and bjor. The bjor skins were for warmth, while the deer hide could be fashioned into many different clothes. The meat, of course, could be preserved as well as eaten fresh. I might have taken Ulla with us, but for two things. I was not sure how he would take to crossing the river, and he was still weak from his privations in the wild. Better to wait until he was stronger and better trained. This would also be the time when we took Waterbird and Brown Feather on the hunt. Last year had been, so my wife had said, too early. This time they would come, and my task would be to see that they came to no harm. We paddled across the river and made sure that the boats were drawn up high above the waterline. Then Mooseblood led the men and boys of the clan towards the Bure lodges. Although Brave Eagle and his clan called them beavers, we used my word for them, Bure. If we had enjoyed the luxury of more metal, we might have attempted to make a trap for the Bure, but I was not skilled enough a metal worker to do that. We had instead some wooden traps we had made. Whilst not as effective, we would catch some, and we would hunt others with arrows and spears. We allowed the youngest boys to help set the traps. Brown Feather had a soaking for his pains, and learned a lesson. His father, Fears Water, laughed at his son's discomfort. Then we went to hunt the deer. We would use metal-tipped arrows. They killed better, and we could always recover them from the bodies and reuse them. Each arrow had been sharpened, and if sent true, would strike deep within the animal and make for a quick kill. This would also be one of the first hunts that I had not led. I had every confidence in my three sons. I knew the others were good hunters too, but I trusted my three boys to do things the right way. I smiled as I saw Mooseblood feel the air and lead us down the trail that would take us to smell the deer before they could smell us. The old father smiled on us that day, for we found the trail of the deer and it was heading away from us. They would stop and graze frequently, and that would allow us to close with them. When it had just been my boys, Hummingbird and Fears Water, it had been more difficult, for we were fewer in number. The extra three, Bjortooth, Longnose and Black Feather, along with my grandson and foster grandson, meant we had more beaters to surround the animals. I stayed in the centre of our line with the two boys within grabbing distance. Mooseblood was ahead, and when he stopped and knocked an arrow, then I knew that we were close. I had no bow, but a spear with a metal head on it. It could be thrown, but I could use it both as a crutch and as a weapon to keep a beast at bay. There were bears in the forests, although as we had neither seen their sign nor smelled their stink, I was confident that we would not find any close by. It was Brown Feather's foot that gave us away. He stepped on a branch that broke, and the herd was close enough for us to see them, and they first heard and then saw us. They started. My sons were the most experienced of hunters, and their arrows flew. I barked, "Stay close to me!" It was a command for the two young boys, as a milling herd would have simply trampled them to death. Herds of deer can be highly unpredictable, and this one was no exception. The stag leading them suddenly whirled and, instead of fleeing us, charged at us. It may not have been intentional. The young animal could merely have panicked, but that mattered not. The 20 or more animals simply charged at us. "Behind me!" The command and urgency in my voice made the boys obey instantly, and I held the spear before me. There was a tree close by, and I edged nearer to it so that we had some protection. The others simply loosed an arrow and then sought cover themselves. As they did so, they formed a funnel into which the herd ran, and it led directly to me. The stag veered towards the trail, and that took him and the majority of the herd away from the boys and me. But panicking deer behave even more irrationally, and a young male, yet to grow his antlers, tried to overtake the others and came directly for me. I could not evade him for fear of him striking the boys. I braced myself and used the tree itself to anchor the base of the spear. I did not have to thrust, because in his blind panic the deer impaled himself on the spear. He drove so hard that his snout was less than an arm's length from me when it died. The boys had come close to death, and I realised that I should have brought Ulla. A snarling dog might have made a deer back off, while an old man with a stick did not. I turned and saw that the boys were shaking. Waterbird had been spattered with the blood of the dead deer. I lowered the spear, and putting my foot on the animal, pulled out the spear, which made a sucking sound. I put my hand on the deer's head. "You were a brave one, but foolish. Graze in Valhalla, my friend." I spoke in Norse, and Waterbird asked me what I said, and I told him. Although the words did not translate well, he understood why I had said them. All creatures were on this earth because of the Allfather, and all needed respect, even in death.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.